The world we all know, which may or may not be the best world possible, once again springtime had come. But all the magic of spring was not enough to conceal the misery of Manor Farm. Once thriving and fruitful, the farm and its owner, Mr. Jones, had fallen on evil days. Beset by problems of his own making, Mr. Jones had turned to drink. And for his misery, he had found poor company. On the evening our story begins, it was later than usual when Mr. Jones came home from his drinking to make his rounds. This night, all the animals had agreed that as soon as Mr. Jones was in bed, they would gather in the main barn for a secret meeting called by Old Major, the prize boar hog, who because of his years was regarded as by far the wisest of the animals. The other pigs started first for the meeting, being clever and fond of taking the lead. They were followed by Boxer, largest and strongest of the horses, and his devoted friend, Benjamin, the donkey. All the other animals, great and small, were anxious to get there, for such a meeting had never been held before. Major had been ailing, and now he had made known there were some things he wanted to say to his fellow animals before it might be too late. It took a while for all to find their seats. The pigs had taken up the best positions immediately in front of the platform. Among them, Snowball, determined to get a good view. And Napoleon, equally determined and even less polite. What was that? No, it wasn't Mr. Jones. And at last, everyone could be settled to hear Old Major.
My dear friends, I have lived a long life. I have had much time for thought as I lay alone in my stall. I won't be with you much longer. And before I die, there's something I want to tell you. Few of us will ever know the blessings of a peaceful old age. You, boxer, when you have given the last of your great strength, what then? Whatever we produce is taken from us, stolen from us, and sold. Our children are born to cold and hunger. Look at them while you can. You porkers, do you know what the future holds for you? Do we deserve such a fate? Is this farm too poor to support us all? No, comrades. When the farm is rich, but we'll never get our rightful share from Farmer Jones. Overthrow this evil tyrant, and we shall be rich and free.
Comrades! Revolt!
But remember, when you have got rid of Jones, don't adopt his vices. We animals are brothers, large or small, clever or simple, fur or feathers. Now and forever, all animals are equal.
The very next morning, sooner perhaps than old Major would have predicted, the animals found their situation quite unbearable. So, almost before they realized it, the animals had fought and won. They had casualties to mourn, and those who died left children to be cared for. But Manor Farm was theirs, and they lost no time in destroying everything that reminded them of hateful Mr. Jones.
Thank you.
When it came to Mr. Jones's house, the animals hesitated. Napoleon showed the way, but Snowball took the lead in entering the place where their tyrant had lived. Animals were all agreed that Jones's house was no place for them. All that is, except Napoleon. Meantime, Snowball led the other animals in organizing a new society, which they now named Animal Farm. So that all might see and agree, the laws of Animal Farm were inscribed in a prominent place, to be remembered and obeyed forever.
No animal shall sleep in a bed. No animal shall drink alcohol. Four legs good, two legs bad.
Wings count as legs.
Equal. tending farm by themselves posed problems for the animals, but the pigs could think of a way around every difficulty. Boxer was the admiration of everybody. He had been a hard worker in Jones's time, but now he seemed more like three horses in one. Instructed by Snowball, other animals worked out the rest for themselves, and the farm work was done like magic. The success of their efforts delighted everyone, including sly Napoleon and his constant companion, Fat Pink Squealer. Summer, the animals, without any help or any interference, made a going proposition of Animal Farm. The fields yielded richly, and they were cut and gleaned with diligence and devotion. With the harvest safely home, the animals had time to think of the future. And at a meeting in the big barn, many resolutions were put forward. It was always the pigs who made the resolutions.
Comrades, our first 5 months' plan is a farm-wide triumph. for the time has come to spread the glorious news so that our downtrodden comrades on other farms will break their chains and join the animal revolution. Go, tell the wonders of Animal Farm to the world!
Some animals, content with their lot, were unimpressed by tales of peace and plenty. Others, happy in their own surroundings, were alarmed at the thought of any change. Wherever they were having a bad time, animals listened with interest. In certain quarters, the rebellious behavior of a lot of dumb animals caused indignation and much conversation. But nothing was done about it, for the drunken Mr. Jones and his cronies did not know what to do. Snowball felt that education was the animal's next necessity. Some of the animals were brighter than others, of course. Snowball set himself to solve the problem of power on the farm. And so did Napoleon. In January, there came bitterly hard weather. Inexperienced management brought shortages to Animal Farm. But Snowball continued his thinking for the future. And in such thoughts, he was not alone.
I have prepared a new plan for Animal Farm. Here it is. All it needs is your vote. At first, we will have to work more and eat less. But my plan will bring us electricity. It will mean a warm barn in winter. A light in every stall. Sty at roost. Luxury for all! Comrades, in one short year, Animal Farm will be the finest in the world.
Dreams, dreams.
A vote for my plan is a vote for the life beautiful.
It's a lie.
I'll promise you a 4-day week.
Bosh.
Perhaps a 3-day week.
Nonsense.
A 1-day week.
With Snowball disposed of, Napoleon stepped up confidently to take charge of Animal Farm. And Fat Pink Squealer became his obedient follower and assistant.
Comrades, Snowball is a traitor. What was he really planning? To bring back Jones. Now, let's have no more of these useless meetings, eh? From now on, I'll protect your interests, and I'll make your decisions. Let me show you my plan for Animal Farm.
And so the windmill was started after all. Nothing could have been achieved without Boxer, whose strength was greater than that of all the other animals put together. Superintended by the pigs, all the animals worked long shifts which lasted from dawn till dusk. rations were shortened for the workers, but the pigs, by virtue of their brain work, were plentifully provided for. But the greatest inspiration came from Boxer, who, with his friend Benjamin, worked early and late, in season and out. One evening, after working long and late, as usual, Boxer and Benjamin made a curious discovery. Of what now went on at night in Jones's house spread quickly through Animal Farm. Some of the animals thought they remembered a law against beds, but obviously they were mistaken. Other changes in the laws of Animal Farm were in store.
Those ungrateful beasts of yours. Cheer up. They won't last. Another winter will bring them to their knees. Anyway, where are they gonna buy the things they need?
In Mr. Jones's circle, the subject of shortages at Animal Farm was a popular one. And a sharp trader named Whimper was just the sort to do something about it.
Of this free village.
chickens seem to remember old Major saying that their eggs should never be taken from them. The innocent suffered with the guilty, and the chickens' uprising was short-lived.
Comrades, I have made a terrible discovery. There are traitors among us. Yes, comrades. In league with Jones and Snowball. To destroy Animal Farm. Who else is guilty? Stand up and confess!
have no more use for that song. See, it is now forbidden. Under penalty of death.
Trade between Animal Farm and the outer world now became quite brisk. As might be expected, Mr. Whimper's profits inspired others to seek their share, or at least give vent to their jealousy.
Animal Farm seems to be making money.
For Whimper.
Whoever heard of animals running a farm? Have you seen a windmill? Come on, let's kick him out.
Yes, kick him out.
The original owner was not invited to join this movement. His neighbors let him know his day was done.
Has mobilized all his forces against us. We must save Animal Farm from the hateful enemy. At all costs, we need animals. Now is the time to fight, to die for Animal Farm. Let us show them all.
Thank you.
Now began the heartbreaking job of rebuilding. And as before, Boxer and Benjamin worked hardest of all. By now, supervision of the work by pigs was hardly necessary, so they had time for less laborious pursuits. Long after the other animals left the job, Boxer and Benjamin worked on and on, giving their all, year in, year out. A new generation of pigs grew up, endowed with what were considered arts and graces very flattering to Animal Farm and its presiding genius. But still the windmill was not finished, and Boxer's injured foot got worse instead of better. It looked as though Boxer were dead, but he wasn't. Not quite.
Boxer's hurt bad. We'll never work again. What do we do?
While Napoleon and Squealer made plans for Boxer, Benjamin predicted he could look forward to a well-earned rest and retirement. Next day, the windmill work went on as usual, but now without Boxer. And during the morning, what appeared to be an ambulance arrived. Only Benjamin suspected it wasn't an ambulance. Other animals finally recognized the death wagon from Mr. Whimper's glue factory.
Boxer!
I was with him right to the end. His last words were, "Forward, comrades! Long live Napoleon!" As for the wicked rumor that Boxer was sold to a glue factory, our beloved leader would never do that. Long live Napoleon! Long live Napoleon!
And that night, the pigs drank to Boxer's memory in the whiskey they had bought with Boxer's life. Years passed. The seasons came and went. The short animal lives fled by. The completed windmill stood as a monument to its builder's faith and sacrifice. But the animal's revolution was only dimly remembered. Outwardly, Animal Farm appeared prosperous. But the animals themselves were no better off, with the exception of the pigs and their supreme leader, Napoleon. His pig-run enterprise now had many of the frills of real civilization. And one fine day, pig delegates from far and wide arrived at Animal Farm to celebrate the coming of a new era. Reports of this great change reached them. Other animals everywhere were incredulous. Dismayed and indignant, they headed toward Animal Farm from all directions, instinctively uniting once again in common cause.
There is order and discipline. Our lower animals do more work and eat less than on other farms. This will encourage you to make your lower animals work even harder and eat even less. To a greater animal farm. To peace and plenty under pig rule. to the day when pigs own and operate farms everywhere.
To the animals, it now seemed that their world, which may or may not someday become a happy place to live in, was worse than ever for ordinary creatures. And another moment had come when they must do something about it.